What type of job can you do with a PhD in STEM? In this series of videos, I'll be talking about 13 different non-academia career paths for PhDs. Welcome to my YouTube channel, Man Shu. I'm a PhD in neuroscience turned machine learning engineer. In my channel, I talk about tech career, machine learning, and my life. Today, let's get started with my personal story about how I gradually changed my mind about academia and started to explore non-academia career paths. 3 years ago, I got my very first job offer as a data scientist and wrote a blog post in Chinese talking about my transition into data science. That blog post has received more than 500,000 page views now. You can find the link to the blog post in the description below. Now I have been working as a data scientist and machine learning engineer for more than 2 years, and I think it's a good time for me to share with you my updated thoughts about data science and non-academia career paths in general. I don't know about you, but when I was choosing my major for college after the college entrance exam, Gaokao, in China, I was basically just guessing. I grew up in a family that worked at a thermal power station. So I put power engineering as my first choice of major, simply because I thought I could get a job in the same thermal power station that my father worked at. I put biology as my second choice of major because I had a very naive interest in neuroscience and psychology since I was in middle school. I remember I was watching this anime called Neogenesis Evangelion, and I was so amazed as a teenager the idea of neuroscience, memory, neurons. I didn't know anyone in my life that majored in biology at that time, and I didn't know what type of job I could do as a graduate in biology. Later, we received a phone call from the college recruiters and were told that the grade required for biology tended to be higher than the grade required for power engineering. So I was asked to put biology as my first choice of major. The good news is I eventually got admitted to the Department of Biology in one of the best colleges in China. Looking back, I just couldn't believe I made such a big decision in life without thinking it through. I didn't ask my cousins who went to college before me what it was like to be a college student or what would they recommend me to go for a major. I also didn't ask my high school teachers to introduce me to their former students and ask for some advice. When the college recruiter contacted me, I didn't ask him what different departments look like or what was the job market for different majors. At that time, all I cared was the college itself, not a particular major. As you can imagine, when I started college in 2007, I was completely clueless about my future. If I had the knowledge then that I'm having right now about the job market or what it's like to be a neuroscience researcher, I would probably be more cautious when I was choosing my major. At least I should look beyond my very naive interest. During college, I gradually learned what it's like to be a real researcher by talking with teachers and senior students. I also further developed my interest in neuroscience as I was taking more neuroscience courses and professional training. My academic research experience started in my second year in college, and I joined a research lab that studied learning and memory. Like many of my peers at that time, I took the TOEFL and GRE exam and applied for graduate school in the United States. When I graduated from college, I was definitely more knowledgeable about the field of neuroscience and research in general. But I never spent too much time thinking about job market, career, and my life. Some of my classmates did internship when they were undergrad and started to work immediately after graduating with a bachelor degree. But somehow, working just never came to my mind. I didn't know if I was subconsciously trying to avoid stepping out of the ivory tower, or I was just following the trend of continuing graduate study. In 2011, I started my PhD program in the United States. Like many of my peers at that time, my goal was to finish my PhD and try to become a professor. In my very first year in the PhD program, I did 3 rotations with 3 neuroscience professors. 2 of these professors were Nobel Laureates, and the other one was also a world-famous neuroscientist. As you can imagine, I was both thrilled, excited, and at the same time, a little bit intimidated and to work with this world-famous neuroscientists. It was also during my first year, I started to talk about job, finally, with my coworkers. I remember it was one afternoon in the November of 2011. I was learning how to inject DNA into neurons from a postdoc. During our break, he startlingly turned to me and said, "Why are you here?" "What?" "Well, you seem to be talented. Why are you in the field of neuroscience research?" "Well, because neuroscience is a very interesting subject and I wanted to know how the brain works. There are other interesting subjects out there too, like finance and banking. Why are you in neuroscience?" At first, I thought he was being discouraging because I somehow failed to impress him with my research skills. But as we kept on talking, I realized that he was genuinely giving me career advice. In my eyes, he was a very successful researcher, a postdoc that was on a good track to become a professor. But even he was hesitating and struggling. Throughout my first year of rotations, I've seen coworkers getting frustrated when their experiments failed, when their paper was rejected, or their grant application was denied. Some lucky ones got enough paper published and got a professor job, while others could spend years and years in the lab trying to accumulate enough amount of papers. So at the end of my first year, I started to question myself whether I was capable of becoming a professor, even though I still had a strong interest in neuroscience research. Somehow, all the three labs that I did rotation with did not have a spot for a new graduate student. So I was forced to find and join another lab. I remember very clearly it was 8 years ago on October 1st, 2012. After sending out a lot of emails to different professors and asked to join their lab, I still did not have a lab. I was feeling very frustrated. So I took the LIRR, the Long Island Railroad train in New York, and went to Long Beach for a walk. It is pretty funny because I've been living in Long Beach since the past 2 years. 8 years ago, while I was still very frustrated, sitting on the bench, looking at the ocean and thinking about my life, I got an email reply from my later PhD advisor and said he would like to meet with me. Until today, I feel very lucky to have my PhD advisor taking me as a student. He provided me a lot of support during my PhD, not only in my academic research, but also in my personal career development. From the second year in my PhD program, I started to attend career panels and learned more about the different career paths for PhDs. At that time, those non-academia career paths were still called alternative career paths, and it was assumed that most PhD in STEM would continue doing a postdoc and later become a professor. Today, the word alternative faded away over time, and now when we talk about career paths for PhDs, academia is just one of them. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the difference between established professors and assistant professors. Established professors who got their faculty position decades ago tend to have a very different job market than today. There were fewer PhD students back then, and thus less competition. They tended to be more strict about the career choice their students make, and may think it is just wrong if you choose to leave academia. Assistant professors, on the other hand, who got their position very recently, tend to have a more updated view about the job market, and they may be more open-minded when their students choose to leave academia. However, no matter whether they are established professors or assistant professors, all professors want their students and postdocs to continue doing research and open their lab if possible. After all, family tree and social connection in academia really matters. That is to say, it is not a good idea if you just show up in the lab and declare that you're going to leave academia. After all, if nothing works out, you may still stay in academia and there's really no need to burn all the bridges. As if for me, before I secured a job offer, whenever someone asked, "What's your plan for the future?" "I'm not sure yet. If I get enough paper published, I'll continue doing a postdoc. Otherwise, I will have to look for something else." And I meant it. Neuroscience has always been my primary research interest. It is just difficult to find a faculty position in the current academia environment if I don't have good publications. The rule of thumb is, as a PhD student, you should always prioritize your PhD research and keep the career exploration on the side. In the next video, I'll be talking about my very first non-academia career exploration in teaching. See you next time!